Our announcements this morning.
Morning. Welcome to First Baptist Church, Panama City. My name is Gary Medlock, and I'm the worship pastor here. Thankful that you're here with us today. Join us for a concentrated week of prayer beginning today through Saturday, May the 4th. We'll gather in small groups in homes to pray for our families, our church, and also our nation. Worship Center will be open in observance of the National Day of Prayer this Thursday, May the 2nd. Abundant Life Singles Ministry presents the topic Making Godly Decisions and discussion this Friday, May 3rd at 6 p.m. over at the Family Life Center. It's a potluck dinner, so please bring your favorite dish to share. Ladies and gentlemen, children of all ages, come and support our First Kids and Preschool Ministries Spring Musical this next Sunday, May the 5th, here in the Worship Center. First Kids will present the greatest hymn on earth. Then our preschool choir will present songs and psalms. This will be a night you don't want to miss. And the Florida Worship Choir and Orchestra will be here with us at FBC on Friday, May the 17th, right here in the Worship Center. This team is comprised of worship pastors, senior pastors, choir and orchestra members, praise team, and praise band members from over 300 churches in Florida. Join us for an incredible night of music and worship as we worship the Lord together. And senior recognition is on Sunday, May 19th, during the morning worship service. Students, sign up by next Sunday, May the 5th, on our website. We're looking forward to celebrating this milestone achievement in your life. At Vacation Bible School, kids will learn to build their life on God's rock with solid truth in a world of shifting sands. That's going to be Monday, June the 10th through Friday, June the 14th, from 9 to 12:30 p.m. Now, this is for preschool through fifth grade. Register your child or you as a volunteer today on our website. Our Music and Worship Arts Camp is going to be Monday, June 24th through Thursday, June 27th from 9 to 11:30 a.m. over in the D building. This four-day music camp offers a variety of beginner music classes for children who have completed grades first through fifth. Children will showcase the skills they learned with a performance at the end of the week. Register today. We have limited spots. Don't forget to do that. As always, don't forget to stay connected with us each week through our social media pages and our website. Stop by the Connect desk in the lobby for service opportunities. Thank you for joining us this morning. Let's worship the Lord together. Thank you.
It's always such a privilege to start the service with baptism and to a picture of what Jesus has done in all of our lives. This is Brian Cruz. Brian, do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
I do.
In obedience to commands of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, I baptize you, my Christian brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with him in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. This is Dexter Tubbs. Dexter, do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
I do.
In obedience to commands of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and upon your profession of faith in him, I baptize you, my Christian brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with him in baptism. Raised to walk. This is Joshua Taylor. Joshua, do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
I do.
In obedience to commands of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and upon your profession of faith in him, I baptize you, my Christian brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with him in baptism. Raised to walk. And this is Tammy Taylor, Joshua's mom. A special time for them. Tammy, do you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
All day long. Yes, I do.
In obedience to commands of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and upon your profession of faith in him, I baptize you, my Christian sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with him in baptism. Raised to walk. Father, we thank you for these who've made the most important decision of their life, to follow you, and then to pronounce that to the whole world through this act of baptism. We pray that you would be with them as they continue to grow and become the people that you created them to be. Continue with us in this service. Let us worship you and hear from you today. And these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. What a way to start the service. Amen. Let's praise the Lord for that this morning. Amen. We're so thankful that you're here this morning, that you're worshiping with us today. If you're a guest, you're a visitor with us, we're so thankful that you're here. There is a information card there in your seat back. If you would take that, fill that out, you can drop it in the offering plate, or you can take it back to our welcome desk at the conclusion of the service. We do have a gift for you. We're just so thankful that you're here with us today and you're worshiping with us. Why don't you stand, greet those around you, and welcome to the services here this morning.
give the Lord a hand clap of praise this morning. Oh, he's so good. And we have the victory, the ultimate victory in Jesus Christ. Let's sing together this hymn that you know of your faith. I heard an old, old story. Let's sing together. Have the victory in and through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. His name is above every other name. We'll just sing together.
You are the Word of the beginning. One with God, the Lord Most High. You're hidden glory in creation. Now
proclaim this, that death could hold our King. Let's sing together.
Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the bones of sin and shame. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever God you reign. And yours is the kingdom, and yours is the glory, and yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name
Praise the Lord this morning.
For God has highly exalted him and given him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. What a powerful name it is. Would you bow with me, please, as we pray together? And our loving Father, we are so grateful that there is something or someone that dwells in our hearts, Lord, that causes us to have a desire to come together on a Sunday morning in a place like this and sing glorious praise to our glorious Lord. God, we're grateful for the gift of music, how it ministers to our hearts, how it draws our attention to you. And we can only imagine what heaven's going to be like as we spend an eternity singing out our praises and worship unto you, the living God. And as we look upon the face of our blessed Savior, and we are able to see the nail prints in his feet and in his hands, God, have the privilege of knowing what our eternity is going to be like. God, we praise you and we thank you for that. Father, I pray in Jesus' name that if there is anyone in this congregation this morning who does not know you in a personal way, they want to, they have a desire to, but they have not come to the place of repentance and faith and belief in the gospel, Holy Spirit of God, I pray that you would work that in their hearts this morning, so that by faith they would trust you and they would believe. Our Father, we thank you for the joy that's ours to be able to spend this week in really a tradition that is over two decades old in the life of this church that we call the Week of Prayer, where we get together throughout the week with small groups, meet in homes. Some will meet here on church property and spend time praying. One of the most beneficial things that we do all year. Because, God, we know that without you, we can do nothing. And so we spend this week in prayer, seeking your face, praying for our church, praying for one another, praying for our nation. So, God, I pray that it would be a fruitful and a productive week as we gather together in the name of Jesus to call upon the living God to do that which we are unable to do. God, we pray this morning for one another. We pray for those in our church family that are hurting. God, that you would be the mender of the brokenhearted to them. We pray for those who need healing, for those who need strengthening and comforting. God, whatever the need might be, I pray that, God, they would discover that Jesus is sufficient. And then, our Father, we do pray for our nation. We pray for repentance to come to this land. Oh, God, how we need a move of God in this nation in which we live. We continue, our Father, to pray for the nation of Israel, to pray for the peace of Jerusalem, to pray for your hand of protection upon those who are still being held hostage in the Middle East. And God, we pray for the destruction of Hamas, those that are coming against your chosen people. Oh God, we ask you that you would stop them, oh God, in their tracks from the destruction that they are causing. We pray for the salvation of the nations, oh God. We pray for the gospel to be proclaimed around the world. And we pray for the offering that we received this morning, God, that you would help us as a local church to do our part in getting out the good news that Jesus saves to all people groups. We love you, Lord Jesus. We praise you. Speak to our hearts out of your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Mistake of thinking that because he had forced the church of Jesus Christ out of sight, that he had stilled its voice and snuffed out its light. But God has always had a people. You see, the powerful current of a rushing river is not diminished because it's forced to flow underground. No, the purest water is the stream that bursts crystal clear into the sunlight after it has forced its way through solid rock. And there have have been charlatans who, like Simon the magician, that sought to barter on the open market this power which cannot be bought or sold. But God has always had a people, men who were beyond purchase, and women who could not be bought. There have been times of affluence and prosperity when the church's message has been nearly diluted into oblivion by those who sought to make it socially attractive, neatly organized, and financially profitable. It's been gold-plated, draped in purple, and encrusted with jewels. It's been misrepresented. It's been ridiculed, lauded, and scorned. You see, these followers of Jesus Christ have been, according to the whim of the times, elevated as sacred leaders and martyred as heretics. Yet through it all, there marches on that powerful army of the meek, God's chosen people who cannot be bought, flattered, murdered, or spilled. On through the ages they march. The church, God's church, triumphant, alive, and well.
Amen. Thank you so much, choir and orchestra. And I thought old Brother Gary was going to start preaching there for a moment. You may have missed your calling, Gary. But that was good. We appreciate that. Invite you to open your Bibles once again to the book of Exodus. Find chapter number 3 as we continue our study entitled Moses, God's Mighty Man. Exodus chapter 3, we're going to read some verses in a moment, and then we're going to be looking at some verses over in chapter 4 as well. October the 31st, 1976, that is a date that if you have been around very long, you have heard me mention that date probably time and time again. So you hear me mention that date this morning and you say, uh-oh, here we go again. Well, I just can't help myself when it comes to that date, because that date is very special to me. That was the day that I was converted to Christianity. That's the day that Jesus became alive and real in my heart and life. But you know, that was not only a special day because that was the day that I was born again. It was also a very special day because that was the day that God called me to preach. I remember going home that night on Sunday night, and I remember I was so excited and pumped up, I could not even sleep. And so I finally just closed my eyes and began to meditate on what had happened that day. And I literally that night saw myself standing behind a pulpit with an open Bible preaching. You say, now, Pastor, was that God's vision that He gave to you about His call upon your life? I don't have a clue. I don't know if it was God's vision. I don't know what it was. All I can tell you is what I saw. And it's just as real today as it was that Sunday night that it happened. Well, God's call was clear, but my response was not so admirable. Instead of falling on my face in surrender and saying, "Yes, Lord, I will do that," I came up with all kind of reasons why I couldn't do that. As a matter of fact, I said, "Lord, this can't be You. Lord, do You really know me? I'm shy. I can't speak in front of people." As a matter of fact, when I have an audience of one, my knees start knocking. So there's no way that can be You. And so for the next 5 years, I ran from the call of God rather than running toward the call of God. And I really do believe with all of my heart, every single day across this planet, that God's call is sent out. And yet the response to that call is not what God would have it to be. And I think what we're going to see is that, you know, God's call is not simply a call to pastors. It's a call to salvation. It's a call to church membership. It's a call to baptism. It's a call to a place of service. And we're going to discover today, as we continue looking at the life of Moses, that you know what? We are not the only ones who have struggled with the call of God. So today let's talk about God's call, our response. If you look in Exodus chapter 3, I want to read verses 10 through 15. The Bible says, "Come now, therefore, and I will send you." And this is God who is speaking to Moses. "Come now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt?" And he said, "I will certainly be with you, and this shall be a sign to you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain." And then Moses said to God, "Indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you,' and they say to me, 'What is His name?' what shall I say to them?" And God said to Moses, "I am who I am." And he said, "Thus shall you say to the children of Israel, 'I am has sent me to you.'" Moreover, God said to Moses, "Thus shall you say to the children of Israel, 'The Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial to all generations.'" Now remember, last Sunday morning, we had looked at the fact that God had appeared to Moses in a burning bush. He had begun speaking to Moses. And he had said to Moses that the cries of my oppressed people, they have come to my ears, and I have heard their cries, and I'm about to respond, I'm about to act, and I'm about to provide them deliverance. And now he's going to say to Moses, "I'm calling you, you're the guy that I'm going to use to send to them to bring about their deliverance." There are three things out of our text I want us to look at today. And number one is simply, down in verse number 10, the call of God. The call of God. And there are two things about that call that we see. Number one, it was a call that came personally. Come now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh, and that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. It was a personal call. Now, I could take the Bible this morning, and I could open it to Old Testament or New Testament. I could walk through it, and I could show you how the call of God has come to individuals on a personal level. It is not simply that God calls corporately. He does. He calls churches to do certain things, but God calls individually. God calls personally. And that is not simply just a call to pastors, but that's a call to anybody who is within the body of Christ and they are seeking to honor God and serve the Lord. Those personal calls will come. Now, the reason that I want to point that out is because I do not think there is a greater incentive for faithful service to God in all of the world than the fact that God calls personally. I mean, you think about that for a moment. The God who created the heavens and the earth, the God, the one that hung the stars and the moon and the sun and the skies, the God who heaped up the mountains and scooped out the rivers and the seas, the God who parted the waters at the Red Sea and the Jordan River, the God who made the axe head float, the God who walked on the water and turned water into wine, the God who raised the dead, is the God who calls us personally. And friend, I want to tell you, a knowledge of that kind of God, that'll float your boat during the rough seas of life. When things get rough in life and you think, I can't go on and I can't move forward, a knowledge of that God will keep you after it. I believe that knowledge that God has personally called you will equip you with a can't quit mentality. Wasn't it Jesus who said, no man who has put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God? What is it that causes us not to look back? It is the knowledge that God has called me. You know, 26 years ago, you voted me in, but God called me. And the fact that you voted me in makes me accountable to you. The fact that God called me makes me accountable to God. And so this call that came to Moses, it came personally, but it also came in verse number 10, purposefully. Purposefully. See, it was not that Moses was unsure of the purpose, because God communicated to Moses in language that Moses could understand. As a matter of fact, God said, I've got a twofold purpose. Number one, in verse 10, I'll send you. And then number two, in verse 10, you will bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And so it wasn't that Moses didn't hear that. He understood clearly what God had told him, two things that I have for you. This is my purpose. Now, God didn't ask Moses' opinion. God didn't say to Moses, what you think about it? God didn't say, Moses, I want you to go out and get together a committee so y'all can discuss the various options. No, God told him exactly what it was that he wanted him to do. And friend, there was only one acceptable option, and that was for Moses to fall on his face and say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, I'll do exactly what it is that you are calling me to do. Now, notice there's something about that plan that I really believe that we need to incorporate into our living when it comes to God's call on our individual lives, whether it's to pastor a church or be a missionary or a Sunday school teacher or whatever it might be. I think there's something that we need to keep in mind that I think Moses misunderstood here. See, I think Moses was thinking that God was calling him to be the deliverer of the children of Israel. God didn't call him to do that. God was the deliverer. Moses was just an instrument in the hand of God to provide the deliverance. And when God calls you and I, along with that call, God's not saying, now I want you to go in your own power, in your own strength, in your own wisdom, in your own ability. No, God's simply saying, look, I'm sending you. I'm the one that's going to do the work. I just want you to be the willing vessel and the instrument. So we see the call of God, but listen carefully. Along with the call of God came the confusion of Moses. And I really think that we see as we think the story through that Moses was a little confused here by his response. I mean, you think about it. God said to the darkness, let there be light. And there was light. Jesus said to the storm, peace, be still. And the winds and the waves obeyed his voice. God said to the whale, swallow Jonah. And the whale swallowed that backslidden prophet. But God said to Moses, I will send you, and you will go and deliver the children of Israel. And Moses said, but I'm not so sure about that. Now, here's the confusion. Why in the world did Moses ever think that he had the right or the authority to defy the command of the living God? God said, this is what I'm sending you to do. This is what I'm telling you to do. And Moses said, but I'm not so sure about that. Now, friend, don't we do the same thing when the call of God comes? So often we dig in our heels and we say, I won't. And every time that we do that, it is always to our own detriment. Here is Moses. He stood toe-to-toe with God, arguing over his job description, as if God didn't know what he was doing in calling him. And we know that in the end, that Moses finally acquiesced. It's not because he wanted to, but he came to the conclusion, it's about the only thing that I've got to do. And he finally acquiesced, and he finally gave in, and he finally said, okay, I will do it. Just like me, for 5 years, running away from the call of God rather than running toward the call of God. And friend, I don't have time to tell you all the things that happened during those 5 years as I was running away from the call of God. But I can tell you there was no peace in my heart. There was no fulfillment in my life until finally I acquiesced. And I said, yes, Lord, I'll do what it is that you're calling me to do. I think it's interesting when we discover that Moses didn't turn out like it was planned for Moses in the palace. The palace, remember when he was there for those first 40 years of his life? He was being groomed to be the next Pharaoh. But he didn't go down in history as a Pharaoh. He went down in history as a prophet, all because he responded to the call of God. Did you know, friend, that you are writing in reality your own history based on what you do with the call of God? And if you respond affirmatively to the call of God and you say, yes, Lord, whether it's a salvation service, whatever it might be, I'm going to tell you, you'll go down in history and it will be something that will be very positive. But if you reject the call of God and you refuse the call of God, I want to tell you the history that's written about you will not be nearly as favorable. So the confusion of Moses. And then that's when we really get in the text. That's kind of like my introduction. And what we see in the text in chapter 3, in chapter 4, just like us, Moses made 4 excuses why he could not respond to the call of God. And I want to tell you, friend, these excuses are as up to date as anything could be, because these are the excuses that we use And these are the excuses that I hear as a pastor when I ask people to do something that I feel like God has put on my heart that they're to be involved in. These excuses. Excuse number one, found in chapter 3, verses 11 and 12. But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt?" So he, God, said to him, "I will certainly be with you, and this shall be a sign to you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain." Now, what was this number one excuse? It was the excuse of inferiority. "God, I'm just not adequate for the job." If anybody ever suffered from an inferiority complex, it was Moses. And so here we see Moses, he's asking the philosophical question of the ages, "Who am I? Who am I?" Friend, I want to tell you, I asked that question when I felt God's call October the 31st, 1976. But God, who am I? My father-in-law was a preacher. He was a pastor, but he had been to school. He was a good speaker. I wasn't. So I asked the question, "Lord, who am I?" That's the same question that Moses asked. And what is interesting is that God didn't answer the question Moses asked, "Who am I?" Instead, God gave him a statement. "But Moses, I'll be with you." You see, the answer to the question of who Moses was found in knowing who God was. Did you know that it's only when we are rightly related to God that we establish an identity that produces a healthy self-esteem? Moses said, "Who am I?" God didn't answer. God said, "I'll be with you." Friend, I want to correct a misunderstanding that's in our world today, and that is we do not improve our self-image by thinking better of ourselves. We improve our self-image by thinking rightly about God, the God who loves us, the God who saved us, the God who forgave us, the God who redeemed us, the God who has given us all of these promises. That's what improves our self-image and our self-esteem. When we understand who the God is that we are rightly related to in a redemptive relationship. And would you not agree with me that God's promise of His presence should have been enough to compensate for Moses' feeling of inferiority? Moses said, "But I'm inadequate. That's who I am." And when he heard God say, "But Moses, I'm going to be with you," that should have solved his feeling of being inadequate. And friend, I want to tell you what was true of Moses is true of us. You know, God calls you to teach a class. "I'm inadequate." God calls you to share the gospel. "I'm inadequate." Should not the promise, "But I'm with you," cure that feeling of inferiority? Friend, you think about it. God calls, we respond, we try to do it. And we say, "But God, I lack wisdom." And God says, "I'll give it because I'm with you. But I lack courage." God says, "I'll give you courage because I'm with you. I lack boldness. I'm shy." God says, "I'll give you the boldness because I'm with you. But I lack power." God said, "I'll give you power because I'm with you." "God, I lack the words to say." God says, "I'll give you the words because I am with you." And you see, the knowledge that God is with us, friend, I want to tell you what, If I did not know that, when I'm sitting on the front row on Sunday morning, I would run out of the building rather than walking to the pulpit. But I have the promise of God. I've responded to the call of God in faith. I'm doing what God called me to do. And God's promise, Craig, I'm going to be with you. And so that was the cure for inferiority. You would have thought that would have cured his problem. And he said, yes, Lord, I'll go. But he didn't. He had a second excuse. Not only the excuse of inferiority, but the excuse of ignorance. Down in verse number 13, then Moses said to God, indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and I say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, what's his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. Then he said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. You know what Moses' problem was here? Same problem that we have. Fear. Fear that someone would ask him a question he did not have the answer for. How many times do we get a case of lockjaw when it comes to doing the will of God, sharing the gospel, talking to people about the Lord, doing whatever it may be, because we live with this fear that somebody's going to ask me a question I don't have the answer for. I mean, here I am. I go out on Monday night on share. I knock on a door. I try to present the gospel, and all of a sudden someone asks me, well, what about those people living in a jungle somewhere who don't even have a Bible? There is not a church within thousands of miles. They've never even heard about God. What about them? What am I going to answer them? What if I talk to somebody and they say, well, you explain to me the dinosaurs. How in the world did God get a dinosaur on the ark? I'm just afraid, God, that I don't have all the answers. Let me ask you a question. Where did we ever get the idea from that we have to have all the answers? Where did we ever get that idea? As a matter of fact, let me tell you something. Not having all the answers, that will not cause people to disrespect you. What will cause people to disrespect you is when they know you do not have all the answers, but you fake it and you act like they do. See, there's nothing wrong with just simply saying, I don't know. I'll do my best to try to get the answer to the question, but I'm telling you, you know, that's a real brain stirrer. I just don't have the answer to that question. Well, God answered his question for his ignorance by revealing himself. And he said, I am the great I am. Now, you know that name, based on the Hebrew characters, became the name Yahweh. That is the name in the Old Testament of God. That is the intimate name of God. That is the covenant-keeping name of God. That was that special name for God. And if we would translate Yahweh, it would literally mean the self-existent God, the God who has no beginning or no ending. And it was like the Lord was saying to Moses, look, Moses, you just tell them that the I am God has sent you. You know, in order to have an adequate answer, we must have adequate authority. In other words, if I ask somebody to come and stand behind this pulpit and teach this congregation on some subject, I would want that person to be an authority on that subject. What God was saying was, Moses, I'm not sending you out to share your opinions. Moses, I'm sending you out to tell people what I have told you. And I have the authority. I have all the answers. Don't worry that you don't have the answers. Moses, you just rest and rely and trust in my presence because I have all of the answers. Friends, listen, that equips you with courage. You know, when I tell someone Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, no one comes unto the Father but by Him. That's not my opinion. That's what He said. And when He calls us, He just simply sends us out as His representative to tell people what He has said, not what we think. I think that after this, we would think, you know what? I think old Moses, about this time, he's ready to give up and give in. But he's not, because we see that he had one more problem and excuse. And that was a feeling of insecurity. Now, look over in chapter 4 and look at verse number 1. God can't do it. And what did that come from? Insecurity. Where did that come from? I'm about to show you. Chapter 4, verse 1. Then Moses answered and he said, but suppose, translate that, what if they will not believe me or listen to my voice? Suppose they say, the Lord has not appeared to you, and they will not receive me, they will not accept me, they'll just reject me. Now listen carefully. Where did that come from? It came from an experience 40 years earlier. Do you remember when we looked back earlier in our study through Exodus where Moses came to the defense of one of the Hebrew slaves who was being beaten by an Egyptian? And the Bible says that he came to his assistance and he killed the Egyptian, hit him in the sand. And then the text went on to say that Moses surely thought that they would have accepted him. They would have said, look, he's on our side. We're going to follow Moses. Did they do that? No. What did they do? They asked Moses, who do you think you are? And they rejected him. Now, I don't know this because the Bible doesn't actually say it, but I believe for 40 years now, Moses had been living with the hurt and the pain of rejection. And he said, I don't want to go through that pain again. And I really believe I'm on something here. I believe that I'm looking into the faces of some people this morning. You tried something for God 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, and it didn't work. You felt rejected. And so now here's your response when God comes along and calls. I'm not about to try that one again. You felt it was the will of God for you to teach class on a certain subject. The class was advertised. Nobody showed up. You felt rejected. How many are here today and your obedience in the present and the future is being controlled by the pain of rejection in the past? That's where Moses was. That's why Moses was struggling with the call of God upon his life, because he just did not want to deal with that anymore. And so he asked a question in verse number 1, which may be the most asked question in the body of Christ today. But suppose, what if? What if they will not believe me? Do you pick up on what's going on here? Moses was so bound by what could happen that he was deaf to the voice of God of what would happen if he stepped out in faith and obeyed the will of God for his life. Do you realize, dear friends, when it comes to that what if question, it has caused many of us to have our feet stuck in the sand and never move forward. What if? What if they reject me? What if it won't work? What if there is not enough money? What if, what if, what if, what if, what if? Let me tell you, imagined scenarios are enemies to us responding to the call of God on our lives. And so God was so good and gracious to Moses that he gave him three examples in verses 2 through 9 of chapter 4 of what he would do if Moses responded in faith and accepted the call. So the Lord said to Moses, "Moses, what's in your hand?" He said, "A rod." He said, "Cast it on the ground." So he cast it on the ground, and it became a serpent. And Moses fled from it. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Reach out your hand and take it by the tail." And he reached out his hand, caught the serpent, and it became a rod in his hand. And then God said, "That they may believe that the Lord God of their fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, has appeared to you, this is what I will do." Then he gave him another example. "Stick your hand inside your coat," and it turned to leprosy. He said, "Pull it back out," and his hand was made clean. Then he said, "If they still won't believe you, then go and get a little water from the Nile, pour it on the riverbank, and I will turn it into blood." In other words, Moses, it's not up to you to convince people that I have sent you. Moses, that's my job. Your job is to just step out in faith and obey the call of God. You would think, surely by now, turn the rod into a serpent, turn the serpent into a rod, made a hand leprous, heal the hand, turn water from the Nile River into blood. You would have thought that by now Moses would have been on his face saying, "Here am I, Lord, send me." But he wasn't. He offered up one more excuse, and that is that he was inarticulate. Chapter 4, verse number 10. Then Moses said to the Lord, "Oh, my Lord, I'm not eloquent." I say, "Me neither. Neither before you nor since you have I spoken to your servant. I'm slow of speech and slow of tongue." Now, I don't know if you picked up on it, but something happened in 40 years. Because according to Acts chapter 7, Moses was mighty in word and deed. No more. What had happened? I believe he had allowed rejection to consume him to the point that he had zero confidence in himself and his ability. I don't know, did Moses have a speech impediment? Did Moses stutter? I don't know. But there's one thing I do know. I do know that God was smart enough to know it, and he called him anyway. Because he said, "Look, who made man's mouth?" And then he would go on down later in the text to say, wasn't it I, the Lord, who did that? So what I want you to see is that for every "I am not" excuse, God responds, "But I am." "I am not articulate," God says, "but I am." "I'm not wise," but God said, "I am." "I don't have all the answers," but God says, "I do." So for every excuse, God just spelled a death knell to that excuse by his response. Do you remember there was a guy in the New Testament who also had a speech impediment that God used in an incredible way? His name was the Apostle Paul. He said, "Now, brethren, when I came to you, I did not come with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I was with you in weakness and fear and in much trembling, and my speech and my preaching were not of persuasive words or human wisdom. Name me somebody God used more than the Apostle Paul. I just believe somebody's here that fits in these categories, and you just believe the devil's lie in telling you, but you can't be used. I'm here to tell you, friend, you can be used. You know, God was so patient with Moses, excuse after excuse after excuse. But God's patience finally wore a little thin. Down in chapter 4, verse 14, it says, "So the anger of the Lord was kindled against Moses. And he said, 'Is not Aaron the Levite your brother? I know that he can speak well. And look, he is also coming out to meet you. When he sees you, he will be glad in his heart. Now you shall speak to him and put the words in his mouth, and I will be with your mouth and with his mouth, and I will teach you what you shall do.'" So Moses said, "I can't speak," and God's patience runs out. And he says, "All right, Moses, I'll give you what you desire. You desire to have somebody stand in your place and be your mouthpiece." Now, let me just stop right there and say, when you're running from the call of God, be careful what you ask for. God might give it to you. Because if you read the rest of the story, I believe Moses reached the point in his life where he said, "God, I am so sorry I asked you to give me Aaron. That was the dude that made the golden calf at the bottom of the mountain that led the children of Israel into idol worship." So be very careful when you're running away from the call of God. Be very careful in what you ask for. God, just take that feeling out of my heart. God, remove it from me. Dear friend, he may very well do that. You know, when I think about these excuses, all these excuses were really birthed from one thing. He didn't want to do it. Down in verse 13, "But he said, 'O my Lord, please send by the hand of whomsoever else you may send.'" Did you get that? God sent somebody else. It's the most popular person in the Baptist church. They're named somebody else. God gets somebody else to do it. God gets somebody else. God's saying, I want you. And we say, "No, Lord, get somebody else to do it." You know, over the years, and I'm old enough where I've learned a few things, and I've learned that usually when the call of God comes on my life about something, there is always the resistance of the flesh. And the problem is, I'm just like Moses was, and I've got a heart problem. I just really don't want to do it. So what have I done during those times? I've gotten on my knees and said, "God, change my heart. God, work in my wanter. God, change my heart to the point where this call of you on my life, that it's something that I want to do." I realize time's getting away, but listen to me. Going back to Egypt for Moses, or you listen, say amen. Amen. Going back to Egypt for Moses was a risk. Huge risk. He had a bounty on his head back in Egypt. Big risk. I mean, I would admit that living in Midian tending sheep was probably a boring life, but it was safe and it was comfortable. Going back there involved risk. Can I tell you what? There's always risk that goes along with the call of God. Always. Because we can't see the future. You want to know the one thing that is the assurance for us when we take a risk to follow the call of God? What is the assurance? It is confidence in the call of God. That is what shores up the risk factor. I can tell you many moons ago, when I left Hilliard, Florida, to go to Dothan, Alabama, to go to Graceville, Florida, to Bible College, I took a huge risk. When we loaded up the U-Haul that morning in Hilliard with two kids, another one in the oven I didn't know about, we took a risk. We didn't even have a home to live in. Now, I had some feelers out, and I had talked with a farmer that owned a farmhouse built back in the 1800s. He said, it's not much, but it's yours for $125 a month if you want to rent it. But I was taking a risk. She had not seen it. I was taking a huge risk. You want to know what gave me confidence and assurance in that risk? The call of God. When we came here, I took a risk. I left a church that loved me. I'd been there basically since its infancy. It was a fruitful ministry. We loved it. And I'm thinking, you know, I'm going to a downtown church in Panama City, Florida. Will they even accept a country boy like me? I don't know. I was taking a risk. But friend, let me tell you something. I'm glad I took a risk. And I bet if we could interview Moses today, and we could say, Moses, was the risk worth it? I think he'd have said, oh, yeah. Think what he would have missed if he would have said no to the call of God. He would have missed the defeat of the pagan deities that he saw. He would have missed the mighty victory at the Red Sea. He would have missed 40 days of intimate fellowship on the top of the mountain alone with God. He would have missed all of that. See, all of those future blessings were hanging in the balance that were dependent upon what would Moses do with the call of God. What future blessings today are hanging in the balance for you, all depending on what you do with the call of God on your life? Here are all of these blessings that God wants to pour out on you, spiritual blessings, and it all depends on whether or not you will say, yes, Lord. Thirdly, and I close, the challenge for us. When we put all this story together, what is the challenge for us? Three quick challenges. Number one is a proper perspective. We need to live life with a proper perspective. What is that? In spite of our shortcomings, failures, weaknesses, foibles, in spite of all of that, God can use us. We ought to live with our motto, when I'm weak, then he is strong. D.L. Moody struggled with the King's English, and he became one of the greatest evangelists that ever lived, instrumental in bringing Billy Graham to faith in Christ. Billy Sunday butchered the King's English. I mean, when he stood to preach, English teachers would cover their ears because he butchered the English language. And God used him incredibly. Dr. M.R. DeHaan spoke with a grovelly voice, much like what you put up with for months until they fixed my vocal cords. And yet Dr. DeHaan became one of the most famous Bible teachers on radio that ever lived. Don't you tell me God will not use our weaknesses. Number two, we live with a proper perspective, but then a proper balance. See, Moses went to two extremes. We got to balance them out. Listen carefully. Two extremes. He failed when he said, I can do it. He went and killed the Egyptian. I can do this. I can handle it. I can put it in my own hands. But he succeeded when he said, I can't do it. See, we live with the balance. I can do all things. What's the rest of that? Through Christ who strengthens me. I really do believe that God wants us to have confidence in ourselves and in our ability, unless it gets out of balance. Remember King David? The slingshot? He was good. He could split a hair at 100 yards. He had confidence in his ability with a slingshot. But remember when he went to face Goliath? He went with his slingshot because he was confident in his ability. But what did he say to Goliath? You come against me with your sword and your spear and your shield. But I come against you with my slingshot. But in the name of the Lord God of hosts, who is the God of the armies of Israel. God wants us to balance it out. Nothing sinful about having confidence in your abilities as long as you understand that's He that gives the victory. But then there's a proper faith. And that proper faith is that God can use our failures to equip us for future ministry. The rejection he faced in Egypt prepared him for the rejection that he would face in leading the children of Israel through the wilderness. You know what trials do when responded to appropriately? Trials enable us to step forward in fulfilling the plan of God for our lives. So let me just ask in closing, what's God calling you to do today? Is He calling you to be saved? Is He calling you to be a pastor, a missionary? Is He calling you to be a teacher? Is He calling you to be a church member? Is He calling you to follow the Lord in believers' baptism? Stop making excuses. Queen Elizabeth, when she was crowned in 1952, those who were of noble blood were sent out invitations. And on those invitations were the words, all excuses set apart. And the idea was, it was unthinkable to offer up an excuse not to attend the Queen's coronation. I'm telling you, when the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords extends an invitation, it is unthinkable to respond with an excuse. Would you stand, please? Heads bowed and eyes closed. And Father, thank you for the lessons we learned from the life of Moses. And God, you have written these things for us in the Old Testament so that we would not make the same mistakes. So help us learn from his example. And God, for whatever the call might be in individual hearts and lives today, help us, oh God, to say, yes, Lord. If it's to be saved, if it's to be a church member, if it's to be baptized, whatever the call is, help us say yes, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Our heads are bowed and eyes closed. No one looking around. God's touched your heart. We invite you to come. Respond to the invitation. Our ministers are down front. They will help you, pray with you, pray for you. Respond to his call.